Skaro!
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Radio Free Skaro, episode number 827. I am Stephen in Edmonton.
Warren in Vancouver.
And Chris in Edmonton.
We're here late on a Sunday night into a Monday morning in most parts of the world to talk about the last episode in a regular season featuring Jodie Whittaker as the Doctor. It's chapter six. It's Flux, the final chapter of that, the Vanquishers is called. I know, it only sort of dawned on me in a scene at some point in this. I don't even remember what scene it was. It just like, oh my gosh, she's going soon.
If she had two more episodes, the last one could be called Chapter 11.
Boo, indeed. That would be actually. That's a good thing they didn't have it. Yes, it would be a bad thing if they did have 11 chapters and you could say Chapter 11. But B, maybe they would have stretched the story out a little more, which perhaps is a foreshadowing of my thoughts upon this episode.
Yes. I think we're all. I don't know what I think.
Are you saying, Stephen, that you have thoughts?
I do. Apparently, also, judging by the informal order of things, this is my turn to go first with my initial impressions of the episode.
Well, then, do so, sir.
And I think, Warren, you commented that the best review you saw so far of Doctor Who Flux was me tweeting the image from Homer Simpson turning everything into a bar. There's an episode of The Simpsons where he's addicted to like power bars and stuff. And so he says, instead, I have made this entire spaghetti meal, 5 pounds of spaghetti into a nice handy bar size. And I think that was kind of
that
the episode. Maybe even the last two
that
episodes.
That is the best review so far.
It was a lot. It was a lot in just over 59 seconds.
Hot mess is what I think it was.
I don't know about a mess. I've seen it said where I think friends of ours said that it was a lot to deal with when you were sort of like having to hope that what you think was going to happen didn't happen. So you were sort of like bracing yourself for bad stuff to happen. And then it didn't happen, which is good. So I feel when I watched this a second time, almost immediately after watching it the first time, I thought, okay, now that I know like, you know, Bell and Vindir aren't giving birth to the Doctor or the Timeless Child.
So
thank God for that. There's no Omega flying in from somewhere.
That would have been rad.
You know, anyway. There's other stuff that I perhaps might have thought would have happened and it didn't happen. And so I kind of enjoyed the ride a little more. If you go in not expecting things or thinking too hard about what might happen, I think it's a much more enjoyable thing. But it just,
I went in just not giving a flying crap about any of that.
I like that. Also, I have to admit, because I know that, I mean, this happens with every Doctor Who's showrunner, Doctor. I didn't really realize this until Jodie Whittaker came along and Chris Chibnall came along. I thought that everyone just loved Doctor Who. Everyone I knew just loved it all equally. And then when Jodie Whittaker's first season came out, which was I was a little bit lukewarm on, and people were telling me, my God, I'm watching Doctor Who again. I haven't even finished the Peter Capaldi years. And they go, what?
There was a backlash. I know some friends of mine who love Doctor Who, Peter Capaldi put them off.
I know.
It was that first season.
And he's my favorite one. And so ever since then, now I'm sort of like, every time I watch an episode, because I know that some friends of ours really like the season, and some are just like, when is Chibnall going? Because I'm going to kick him out the door. And so like, now it's tough to watch an episode with going, there's friends of mine that really hate what's going on right now. And so it's this all goes through my head as a Doctor Who fan with friends. This didn't happen when I was a kid, when I had A, no friends, and B.
A what now? Doctor Who fan with friends?
I know. I didn't have friends, and I didn't have friends who liked Doctor Who, so I could watch, you know, The Twin Dilemma quite comfortably and not worry about if people thought it was crap or not.
You're veering scarily towards those guys who show pictures of old McDonald's from the 70s and go, we used to have a real country back when I could smoke and eat a burger made of diseased animals.
Now, Warren, you're getting perilously close to where many crucial meetings happened between Neil Burnside and Bob Ross and the Sandbaggers.
That is a fair point. That is a fair point. Détente was established there.
Maybe don't use that example. It happened. Man, I see those. Is that McDonald's in London or wherever they shot it? I don't know if they shot that in Leeds.
It can't be.
I want it to be there in its original 1978 form. Anyway, I just thought it was a lot.
If it is, I'm going. I guarantee it.
I thought it was a lot. I really enjoyed the ride, but there are some parts that I think we will probably pick some nits over. But with that, I look forward
to this.
Yeah. I'm gonna go Warren first.
Sounds good.
Because I feel like
you want me to do the bad first or the good first?
Just general overview, thoughts, impressions.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, my general overview is it was a hot mess. Some parts of which were good and some parts of which were bad. It was really hard to follow the first time. I was like borderline confused for a lot of it. And then the second time, like, oh, okay, this is all falling. Just because there was so damn much of it. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll go with the good first. I thought Jodie Whittaker was in top form in this. She was phenomenally good.
Really good.
Like, she was really funny, really, you know, serious when she needed to be. Back and forthing with herself was great. That was just fantastic, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The Santarans, too, other than one particular scene, which I both liked and disliked, the chocolate scene, which I thought was really funny, but also kind of terrible,
right. But
also kind of funny. Like, it seemed like a weird thing to hit the brakes and have them go, I'm addicted to Mars bars, but it was also kind of amusing to see this insane potato yelling about, I need your delicious bars covered in paper. almost all the Santaran lines were great. Your ceaseless wittering, like all that stuff. Like, also, there's a Santaran scientist who shows up to give a report, and he's wearing a little lab coat. It's great.
Is he really? I didn't notice that.
Yeah, it's like a translucent, it looks like a raincoat, but it's, I guess, the Santaran version of a lab coat.
I never noticed that. Or is that just the hologram? I thought it was just the hologram, maybe. But
maybe.
I'm not going to doubt you, but.
I thought Jericho's send-off was really good. I thought he did quite a good job with that.
Yep.
And I thought the reconciliation between Yaz and the Doctor was really well played, too. Like, kind of quiet.
Mm-hmm.
Although I saw friends of ours said, I believe it was Sage Young said, they were going to kiss! Come on! It sure as hell felt like they were going to kiss. There was going to be some Thasm in there.
You know, we waited basically six episodes for the Doctor and Yaz to have a moment. But also, I think ever since John Bishop was announced, we were thinking, oh, how is he going to walk in on stuff? I just, like, stop it dead mm-hmm. in its tracks. And it didn't happen, and it didn't happen. And then at the very end of episode six, it happened. He got
Come
in
on.
The way.
We need our Thasmin. We might still get our Thasmin. Okay, so here
wheel.
Comes the bad.
Okay.
Here's my bad. Okay. Who the hell is Time? I don't even know what the Azurin Swarm. Like, they're fun to look at. They look like glittery maniacs, but what are they actually for? Like, they just kind of sit there and go, oh, we're going to run Time back and forth through space and destroy it and destroy it again. I'm like, get to the damn point, would you please? Like, what are you actually doing here? Like, and then they go to Time, and Time is just kind of floating around, and maybe it's sort of the equivalent of a white guardian or black guardian saying, off you go, Doctor. You're going to die soon. Ha ha, here's your tenant preconceived death thing. There's no real division. There's no resolution to the division story unless that's coming a couple specials down the road, which I'm getting a little sick of it, frankly. It's like, are you guys going to resolve this thing or aren't you? And it turns out they're not. She's going to drop the watch into the bowels of the TARDIS, which I kind of see the point of, but also I'm like, you led us astray for six episodes just to have her go, eh, to hell with it, which I understand, but it's also kind of irritating.
Mm-hmm.
Also, they kind of got the Fugitive Doctor in a couple ways. It would be nice to see some more of her. It's a little more payback with that. Here's my biggest problem.
Okay.
there's three, possibly four genocides in this. The Doctor doesn't seem to care about one bit. Like the Daleks, the Cybermen, then the Santarans, which they actively participate in. You could kind of blame the Santarans for the Daleks and the Cybermen. But then also, theoretically, there's millions of people inside Passenger until the Flux goes in there and wipes them all out. So Because aren't all the passengers supposed to have millions of people inside them?
I think, well, some,
although we never actually see that.
I think then they basically they get emptied because Azure and Swarm are basically using their life force to,
I guess,
live,
yeah,
essentially. You know,
I suppose
to bridge the gap also, between time and space.
And this is more of the season as a whole. Like when the woman was turned into Azure at the beginning, I bet mm-hmm. you this is something, and I'm sure you'll go into this. Where they had 10 episodes, and we would have seen a lot more of that couple or some sort of reason for that happening, but we didn't see anything. She just became Azure, and we're like, well, she's Azure now because some drone showed up, whatever. Right. Like, and that was never really resolved. They're now ascending, whatever that means, unless they're coming back again too, which honestly, after 6 episodes, I've had enough of Azure and Swarm.
Right.
So that's kind of, in a nutshell, what I thought.
Mm-hmm. All right, then. Well, Chris, you've heard Warren's.
I have one more thing. One more thing.
Warren has one more thing. Sorry.
Yes. Dan, getting shot down. If Diane had been just a museum touring this whole time, that'd mm-hmm. be understandable because he took... But she's been inside passenger, traveling in the TARDIS, mm-hmm. all this other stuff. Why is she shooting him down? Like, I mean, yeah. I guess she's got every right to do it, but it doesn't make any sense. Like, it just didn't feel like a fit.
That's that poorly. Because yeah, like you say, like if she didn't see all the stuff that she saw to know kind of partly what he's been going through, mm-hmm. then that'd be a different story. But she did. She figured out for, you know, passenger to suck up the remainder of the flux. And
yeah, she was,
you
know, involved with all this.
She was
stuff,
involved so with the resolution, and
right. I mean, she that's just not want to go out with him. But he
cold,
was late is not a legit
move.
Excuse. Yeah.
Yeah.
Chris, your initial thought. Warren sort of branched into his full thoughts on that, but on the episode. But what do
well,
you
like you, I've got a good number of notes here, but I'm not going to get into them just yet. So, initial thoughts was, yeah, it was fine. It did what it was supposed to do. Wrap things up.
Good.
Like, I mean, I don't know what people wanted or expected out of this. Like, going back to what you were saying earlier on about. Friends of ours and their thoughts on this, like, man, I was hate watching so much of Tennant because not a good doctor. And
disagree, hard disagree.
I do wonder. I mean, just on that, I do wonder how you would feel now because I think you've mellowed a bit past 10 or odd years since Tennant was Doctor Who. That I think maybe you would be less. I don't like this episode.
I think so.
Yeah,
I think so.
Yeah,
I've softened a lot. Like when I bought the Tennant Years Blu-ray set. Whenever the heck that came out, I watched it almost front to back. I skipped a few things, like the story which shall not be named, but
and Fear Her as well, probably. Yeah.
No, I watched Fear Her.
He likes
I like Fear Her.
Sorry,
he likes
it. But yeah, no, I softened a lot on Tennant over the years, and, but still, like at the time, I was hate watching it for good chunks of it. And if that's what people are still doing with Whitaker, well, yeah, okay, fine, it's your turn. I don't really care one way or the other. If you're pleased or displeased, I mean, mm-hmm. you're still watching.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, yeah. So, chapter 6. So, yeah, like I said, it was fine. It did what it needed to do.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what people expected. You're gonna have to wrap up a lot of the aspects. You're gonna leave some of the stuff not wrapped up to go forward for, you know, setting up her generation or whatever. We got that with her. Her conversation with time.
Mm-hmm.
I went after watching for the third time today because I wanted to make sure I saw it as many times as I could.
Right.
Went back and watched the first roughly 20 minutes of the Halloween Apocalypse just to kind of refresh my memory about where this all began.
That's not bad.
And bad so I got to see, like, you know, the Carbonisa's introduction and Dan's kidnapping or rescue / whatever, the regeneration of Swarm, and I stopped just before the introduction of Azure. And yeah, so it was good to have that refresher, and that I think helped ultimately, because now I, you know, if you know where you were and you know where you're gone, it makes it more satisfying. And
the best place to find out where you're going is to find out where you come from and then work backwards.
Sure.
Yeah,
but yeah, no, like it wasn't fantastic. It wasn't this hot mess. Like it was somewhere in the middle.
Warren called it a hot mess. Warren called it. He called it a hot mess. You're officially arguing with Warren.
Warren's completely wrong.
Okay,
so, but that's
well.
That's
I disagree. I am not completely wrong. It is a hot mess. But anyway.
So yeah, I mean, Okay, I don't know what people expect. Warren, what did you expect? Like, for this hot mess, like, what resolutions did you think would happen versus what we got, and where did your expectations fall short or get met?
I didn't expect this much that didn't amount to that much. So, and also, I forgot about the Grand Serpent, who doesn't do a lot of anything. Also, who's that guy he drags up to say, where's Kate Stewart? I'm like, who is that guy?
I didn't know who that was either.
That's in my notes as well. I was like, who the frick is this guy? Some rando.
I literally used the word rando, for that. I didn't know what that was.
I say a hot mess because there's just a lot of threads to tie up, and I'm not sure half of them got tied up in the first place, and the other half got tied up satisfactorily. I guess they kind of did, but right. I mean, I don't know.
Well, that's what I'm asking, though. It's like, okay, most things did get tied up. But what, like, as far as the satisfactory or unsatisfactory
the crux of it all is, if I had any idea what the hell Swarm and Azure actually want, besides watching a videotape go back and forth at the end of the universe, then maybe I'd be a little more satisfied. But the thrust of the whole series is kind of like, whatever. So
Swarm, when he's introduced in the Halloween Apocalypse, makes mention of, or rather the division guards that are looking after him make mention that Swarm has been there since before the beginning of time. So, like, he's been confined the whole time. So
you'd think he'd be a little more interesting at that point, but no.
Well, no, I was going to say that kind of the justification of him and Azure wanting just to watch things die, because, I mean, well, they missed him or whatever. I can understand that.
I guess. Motive. I don't know. Having to think about it doesn't make it better. So, I can't justify not liking broccoli. I don't like it. Like, it just didn't click for me the way it did for you. That's nothing. I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm just saying it didn't click for me the way it did for you.
Well, like I said, it was satisfactory. It did what it needed to do.
Left open
a little bit, and you never know which things are going to fall into which category, but we got some stuff for the remainder of Whitaker's run, and we got most of what Flux introduced tied up.
Also, don't take my word for it, because I love the way Time of the Doctor resolved most everything, and most everybody disagrees with me on that, so to hell with it. Like, whatever.
Right. I think it's funny, you're just talking about things like the Grand Serpent and Unit. I suppose I'm quite happy that they left a couple dangling threads, because they might have tried to, close more loops in the short amount of time that they had. I still think that this episode and the last one should have been three total. There just wasn't the breathing space. That's my only complaint.
Yeah,
is that there?
Thank you. You said what I was trying to say.
There wasn't.
Okay. Can't argue that.
It was all punchline with no joke. There's no build up to it. And we just sort of saw exactly what needed to happen in the scene without sort of the justification of why it happened, I think, a lot of the time. I mean, I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, did we need the Grand Serpent and Unit at all in this whole thing?
Yes.
You think so? I mean, I suppose there is a way.
The Grand Serpent with Unit, maybe not, but the Grand Serpent in general, yes. Because the whole point of Vinder is he's exiled because of what he reports of having seen the Grand Serpent do in that diplomatic meeting. So you gotta have that, or that's incomplete. But the question mark of the Grand Serpent working with Unit or infiltrating Unit to work with the Sontarans, whatever, that's a
bit of
a mess for sure.
Yeah, I feel like
that's a bit of a mess.
They've already sort of like worked into it once. Like, oh, the Flux is here. Hey, we're now fighting the Crimean War. I feel like that there's already been a precedent for them sort of like to, unless the Grand Serpent was behind that too. I don't know. Was he working that long back into the past? Or
and equally as importantly, why would the Grand Serpent give a crap about Earth in the first place, given he's from
wherever he's from?
Space.
If Earth was the last part of the Flux's path, which it's not, we know, because whatchamacallit in the temple planet is, then I could see him having more of a stake in Earth and wanting to do something there, but it isn't, so it's not very well explained why he's even bothering.
No. No, I feel like there's probably like a I compared this on a Slack too. I remember when YTV was airing Doctor Who in episodic form, but it was in a half an hour time slot, and then along came The Trial of a Time Lord Part 14, which is 29 minutes and 30 seconds, which is already jam-packed with everything, probably too much. So YTV took the bold decision to, in order to fit into its time zone, chopped out 5 minutes, including speeding up the opening and closing credits. And I remember watching that at the time going, this would make no sense to anyone. And I feel, oh, there's like a 71-minute edit or an 82-minute edit of this episode. That is like probably has everything breathing and like there's a natural build up to things. And I just like that is the one that I want to watch. You know, I think kind of like Ghost Light, too. Let's face it, Ghost Light is, and in mm-hmm. one could argue Curse of Fenric is a little bit too tightly packed, I think, given that those episodes were way over long, like 38 minutes, I think, in the case of part four. I just wish it could have breathed. I was thinking about this.
Uh-huh. Sorry, go ahead.
I just said I enjoyed most of the things that happened in this episode, but I just wish that there were more beats to them, you know, basically.
Sure. I was thinking more about the overall series, but I was thinking this is kind of like when the X-Files, when you think about the X-Files after having watched it, mm-hmm. it turns out the Monster of the Week stories are the way better shows. And that's kind of what this was. You know, the Angel story, and I'm probably missing a couple, but the ones that were more focused on a story, with their stuff threaded through, worked better than this. Holy crap, everything's... This reminded me of when RTD would be out of control, throwing everything at a wall, Journey's End kind of type stuff.
Yeah. Actually, that's funny you mentioned that too, because I sort of had that in the back of my head, because I was thinking, you know, I've been thinking all about the Beatles this week because I watched Get Back and I absolutely adored it. And, you watch that being made and it's four lads from Liverpool, five if you can include Billy Preston, in a room making music and recording it just like that. And if you didn't know what the final product of that was, you'd think this is amazing. This is like just stripped back, stripped down Beatles, just playing music and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then you listen to what it happens. And of course they abandon it. And Phil Spector comes along and puts a choir and an orchestra and everything. It just ruins half the songs on that. And I'm thinking, I was thinking about, one of my favorite season finales is The Big Bang, Pandora Opens, and about how the first episode of that is legions of Romans and all this like jumping around in time and space, and the whole galaxy is swirling around. There's Daleks and Sontarans, and you think, oh wow, how are they going to top this? And the next episode, there are four characters in it. There's the main cast, and it's stripped right down. And I really appreciate that because you have all this character time. But I think when you jam so much into a story like they did here, I think, you know, there at one point, like we miss out, like I'm just watching the episode in front of me, like, you know, Di is for some reason the only person still left alive in Passenger. And she's like pretty good at using a laser gun, probably not just from Laser Quest. You know, there's a whole backstory there. I would love to know. How did she get so good at that? I feel like there could have been a lot more exploration.
I think COVID's got something to do with this. I bet you this probably was a 10-parter or something similar. And it would have worked better.
Maybe
it wouldn't surprise me if a lot of it... What's that?
Maybe the 8 that was originally surmised.
Yeah, I think they probably had to make compromises, which you can't fault them for that. Of course, it's a pandemic. But.
It's funny. I watched Star Trek Discovery, and there's no spoilers, but in the most recent episode, there's a scene in like the mess hall and on the ship, and you look around, and there's two characters having a conversation over a meal, and you realize there's no one in this entire cafeteria. And you think, that's COVID.
Although in the old show, it was the exact same thing.
Well, I know, but like, that's COVID.
60s.
I bet you, and this kind of at the time is sort of like, oh, this seems really weird. But remember they had that awesome Temple of Atropos set. Remember that? It was a cool set. And then in the finale, they are quite clearly standing outside a museum on the corner. You can even see the staircase leading up to it, to the entrance of the building. I'm guessing that was probably shot outside because maybe there was a COVID scare or something. And they said, instead of doing it in the studio, we have to do this outside in order to
during one of the lockdowns.
During one of the lockdowns.
Not their fault.
It's the abandoned hospital ward of the invasion of time for the 21st century, essentially. Yeah, they did what they had to do.
Looks better than that.
Yeah. No,
you could be right, but I mean, also by the same token, as far as breathing room and whatnot goes, I'm not going to sit here and try to figure out what could have been not put in there in the first place. But if Chibnall hadn't pulled so many threads to begin with,
yeah,
that's a good point.
If he had less to deal with, less to wrap up,
mm-hmm.
that would have also extended the breathing time without necessarily having to extend the number of episodes.
Yeah, I do. What was it you, Warren? You just said like maybe this was like an 8-part, or was it you, Chris? I can't remember.
I think it was Chris.
It feels like this was an 8-part.
Well, because originally what was going around in the rumor mill was 8 episodes for series 3.
Yeah, I wonder if Chibnall says, okay, there's COVID, let's make maybe an 8-part series, and I'll write here's the story and how it goes, and then they maybe the bean counters and the health and safety people said, so you know what, here's what we're going to have to do to make each episode. And they probably looked at it and go, mm-hmm. well, maybe 6. Maybe we can do 6.
And they pulled it off. Like, they did make 6 in 2020. So, I mean, more power to them.
It's still a remarkable achievement. I just think it was all just sort of ended. I mean, there were... I recently did a podcast on the Brandon Peters Show talking about Spinal Tap, and which is one of my favorite films, and they shot like 6 hours or more, I think 100-minute hours or something like that. The rough cut, the initial cut was 6 hours long. They chopped everything out of that to make it a lean 82 minutes. You know, they really killed
That's standard for movies.
They really killed some babies in order to just sort of really pare it down, and it's
That's a standard term.
It is. And I think there was a lot of like in this where it's like, oh, we can't do that because then, you know, there might be a lot of scar tissue. I feel like almost like, well, we'd have to write a goodbye scene for Jericho taking him back to 1967. Mm-hmm. So maybe we'll just kill him instead because he doesn't really die for any reason other than his mm-hmm. transit. You know, he doesn't die heroically. I mean, he has a great heroic moment.
Kind of does, yeah.
But he's not sacrificing himself to stop the Sontaran invasion. It's already going to happen, and it does, you know.
In my notes, I put, Jericho losing the transmat ring and having it shot is Adric death level bad.
You didn't like that bit? Yeah.
Oh, no,
Kate Stewart
terrible.
Doesn't have a whole lot to do here. And after a great fanfare bringing her, which she deserves because she's Kate Stewart, she doesn't do much besides kind of hang out in a tunnel area.
As we talked about last time, like Kate Stewart shows up, like, what, 85-90% through the episode before we even see
her. And we're all like, yeah, Kate Stewart's back, and then she doesn't do anything, which kind of sucks because she rules.
I almost wish that they could just throw it in one line at the end when they're dropping her and Claire off in the 21st century. You know, it says, you know, okay, good job, Kate, keep doing that. I thought, rebuild unit. I just say that, rebuild unit.
She's going to come back, though. I mean, when they show, not the last I've seen this regeneration, that's clearly she'll be back for whatever the finale or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Here's hoping.
There's definitely a reasonable chance for sure.
Yeah. I know we're kind of all over the place on this, but maybe we're not.
That's fine.
Well, so was the story.
I suppose.
Somebody was concerned.
I'm just consulting my notes briefly here. Warren, you let off your bit with Jodie Whittaker, who is fabulous.
Great in this. Yeah.
That's what I get really like, oh man.
Really funny too.
Like really funny, really good. I loved her complete dismantling of the Grand Serpent.
Oh, that was great, yeah.
like only a woman could do to a very overconfident man. I just thought she just chopped him down to size repeatedly.
It was great.
I liked it that there was three of her. I liked that there was, we had a multi doctor.
She's got a massive crush on herself. I thought that was fantastic.
That was fun. You know?
No, it was not.
You didn't like that? You didn't like that bit?
Oh, God, no.
Oh!
No.
Let's hear why.
Yeah.
Well, so I just, let me find what I wrote here. I'm not sure we needed the doctor fawning all over herself.
Oh, I thought you didn't like the idea of the multi doctors.
Oh no, the multi doctor is fine. I just hated her. Her like, oh, I think I'm going to crush on her. Like,
no, I thought that was great.
That's horrible, horrible, pointless. But when I brought that up, Kat was like, well, if that happened to Tennant or Smith, they would totally do the same thing.
Totally,
Tennant for
like,
sure.
Smith definitely. Smith.
Amy did it in that two part mini thing for the DVD, whatever that was. Yeah, that's precedent.
Yeah. Time and Space. Was that the one?
Yeah. Time and Space.
I think so, yeah.
That's the one, yeah.
The two parts.
Capaldi would give himself a stern telling off, I think.
Not related to Time and Space in this episode, you understand.
No.
No.
But, the whole, I didn't
like it.
It's just an offhand line. I thought it was fun.
Yeah.
Oh, it was, yeah. It's, yeah.
but she was fabulous.
I'd rather have Yaz say something like that.
Yeah, but she was really good.
Speaking of Whitaker and the Doctor and Yaz, at the end, the whole apology for not including Yaz, Jodie Whittaker doesn't, for the first half or so of what she's saying, doesn't even look at you. I can't even look her in the eye. Just she just sold that so well.
Mm-hmm.
She performed that with just magnificence.
And the tear. And the one single tear.
Here's my other thing about having three of her. I'll take these three 13s over a human 10 any day of the week.
Take that Journey's End.
Boy. Still waving that flail in a 10-year-old episode.
I thought the scene with her and Azur basically talking about, you know, like, why is your philosophy? Why is life such a good thing? Why are you so against our
faith?
I know. It was a well-written scene. It was very well acted. I just like, you know, when Azur sort of says, like, but our vision is true. And just that look of, like, you know, like she's arguing with, like, a QAnon supporter or something like that. Like, she's lost. Like, I am not going to convince this person of, and she just realized that the battle's lost. And she, you know, she was just fabulous.
I got to tell you, though, I've seen QAnon supporters protesting, and Azur is a much better dressed and stylish person than most QAnon supporters, all QAnon supporters.
I'm sort of rolling down here. I'm really happy that Bell and Vinder are just having a normal kid. It's not the Thomas child. That made me very relieved because I was really worried that they were sort of trying to work in an actual origin story of the Doctor, but nope. It's still a mystery, and she still wants it to be a mystery. She doesn't, but she feels it's best that it remains a mystery when she dropped the fob watch down the waste disposal chute or some...
so we're Oscar the Grouch list.
Yeah, we some storage unit. Tech Tayun is dead. She actually is dead.
or unless she's coming back again. Like,
I think she's dead. Yeah. I think she's dead.
Because they've left enough dangling with this division stuff that we're going to hear something about this. Like we're probably not with the Eve of the Daleks thing. There'll be like some little hint of whatever for the next one after that. But
yeah, I feel like maybe this will be in the Easter or the final episode. Maybe it's the final episode is when we'll see this, because Carvanista can't say anything. Do we see Carvanista again? Do we see the long running adventures of Carvanista and Bell and Vinder? I wonder.
Why not? I would watch that. They seem to get along well and not get along at all.
Damn right. Yeah.
I think you're right. I think Texan is dead. But, I mean, given Azur and Swarm can undo things that they have done, if there are any other Ravagers out there, maybe they can undo Tectune's death.
I don't know. I think that whole ship of theirs in between the two universes is gone based on that poor Ood who...
But the Tectune thing just seemed so abrupt. It just seemed too abrupt that they got something up their sleeve, I hope, anyway.
Ashad felt abrupt, too, last year. So
that's true.
And he ain't coming back, so... I want to see inside that haunted dream house because it was freaky and looked really cool. And it's not looms.
Oh yeah,
it is nothing. As far as we know, it has nothing to do with looms in Lung Barrel. Yeah,
that's I forgot to put that on my good list, but right. I really liked how they used the old color correction there to have her in black and white and Swarm and Azur in color. I thought that was really well done.
Yeah,
it looked really good. My big thing about that was. Every time we've seen fob watch action in the past, watch opens, memories come flooding back. Why do we have this extra layer of fob watch opens, Doctor gets transported inside for something?
I wonder.
And then there's the house where the stuff actually is. Like, why do we need this extra step other than just to have Swarm do his thing?
Maybe here's my headcanon to this. Maybe the actual, because Jacoby's master opened it himself. The mask, we don't see the Doctor in human nature.
I wonder if somebody else opens
it. Jodie hits the fire saying, they open it up, it's not like you're the actual
Joe Martin, you mean?
Yeah. Joe Martin, I mean, yeah. So that was my headcanon. Yep.
That makes sense. Yeah, well, no, that seems good across my mind. Anyway. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Speaking of color correction and direction, boy, I love the wipes. I love the Star Wars type wipes in between different scenes from Azur Salim. Well done. I enjoyed a lot of the direction in this. Well done.
And I know Warren kind of let things off by being, I'm not going to say negative, but critical. I want to throw out one critical thing about Azir Salim's direction.
All right.
With the introduction of Kate Stewart in the episode, the whole from below pan in, music swells, I'm Kate Stewart, I'm the leader of the human opposition against us. Gag me with a spoon.
It felt like there was an edit. Wow. I felt like there was an edit in there.
Yeah.
There was definitely a change in momentum, I think. I think that was probably one of a few edits that were chopped down to get this to a 60-minute slot. That's what it felt like to me, anyway. But you were probably thinking of, I'm the Doctor, I'm 903 years with the constellation of Gustavros, and I'm going to save everyone on the ship. And of course, you
did. I wasn't, but I am now.
Yeah, same here.
From your favorite
and just to go back to the... To go back to the Fobwatch briefly, just in the live stream chat, there's the mention of in Human Nature, Thomas Sangster's character opening the watch and seeing the Doctor's memories as well.
Oh, that's true.
That's true, so, but it does not restore the Doctor's memories, yeah.
No.
Rather,
the Doctor does twig onto it. Yeah, exactly.
He does. So basically, you have to open it yourself. It's kind of like basically Face ID on a phone. Like, you know, you can type in a password and say, yes, that's my phone, but you actually have to unlock it. And that's how it works.
And if you got your hand over your eyes and glasses off, it's not going to recognize you.
Yeah. I don't know about that.
don't step on my allegory. what did I say here? I like the wipes. I like that. Who is the rando? Who the Grand Serpent? I felt like that was probably lost in an edit. Kate Stewart probably bought something at a corner shop, and that was the guy who was running.
Or the kids showed her the way to the tunnels or something, or you know, and it's like a little 10-second thing they had to get rid of.
Yeah, I feel
I could see him being like a hoodlum on the corner who saw the Suntarans go into a corner shop and reported.
Who are you? Social workers? That's what he probably said.
I was waiting for that. Yeah. But also, I noticed, and this is entirely on me, when they did all the stock footage of all the Suntarans retreating, we can go off into our shield, blah, 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 and they're in Brazil, and there's a shot of, like, I guess it's by the river or something, and there's, like, this little tourist boat going by. I'm like, why is that tourist boat going by when they're under Suntaran occupation? And the answer is, it's stock footage they're using, obviously. Yeah. Nobody cleaned that up. But I was like, wait a minute, what's going on there, boat?
Or I think it's actually a deliberate homage to some location footage in Dalek Invasion of Earth, which of course they went and did at like 5 a.m. in a Sunday morning. But there are still a couple vans driving around in the background, a couple shots because they couldn't actually close down the traffic.
Dinosaurs.
Or Invasion of the Dinosaurs. So obviously, that's the obvious answer. Obvious answer.
Or they bought stock footage.
They bought stock footage. It's probably...
which everybody does. That's no big deal. Well, like, that's a standard practice.
They didn't go to Brazil to film that. I will.
No. Every giant $100 million films get stock footage. It's fine.
Oh, yeah, they do. And stock music sounds. Every time I hear a turkey gobble, I think that's the same turkey gobble sound I hear in Age of Empires 2.
How many Wilhelm screams have you heard in your day?
Oh, many. Oh. You cannot hear it. Three. Also, the Half-Life door sound has been used in so many movies. Oh, I'm like, what am I, Black Mesa? What's going on here?
Thank goodness for Airplane 2 doing it differently than everyone else.
I find, like, I'm just looking for title significance. The Suntarans are apparently the Vanquishers because they actually say, the Suntarans could be the Vanquishers. So,
And I got to say, well played, Suntarans. This is your best stratagem yet. Well, actually the only good one. Also, I do love that they singled out the Rutans to just give them a hard time. It's like, we're going to make an alliance, but not with you scumbags.
Yeah. All
the Rutans remain hideous scum.
That was hilarious. I loved that they took time to just crap all over the Rutans.
All credit to the Suntarans who have twice come up with, like, some of the most, you know, they almost took over Gallifrey in the Invasion of Time, and they almost took over they lured the Cybermen and the Daleks into thinking, they seem by the level. I think we could probably agree to a meeting with them behind the lines here. And
there's, this is a bit of a stretch, but there's a show called Made in Canada, which is from the 90s. Rick Mercer wrote it, and it's all about TV production. It's spot on, but there's a great line that I'll never forget where a guy is trying to sell his shows, and he goes, we're absolutely first rate in producing third rate content. That is the Suntarans in a nutshell.
Yeah.
First rate at producing third rate content.
I'd
put a note that overall Commander Skank, horrible name, but whatever.
Stank.
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 What were you watching, Chris?
Even still.
Stank. Never mind, don't answer that.
he's pretty badass and effective. I loved his demeanor talking to the Doctor and Carvanista when they were in the cell.
Yeah.
His allusion to having killed off the Lupari and just said, "Oh, you must be mourning them." And meanwhile, Carvanista has no clue what's going on yet. Mm-hmm. And, you know, saying to the Doctor, "Oh, finally where you should be in a cell," what a kind of thing. It's pretty good. Like, as Sontaran stuff goes, that's far and away the most effective we've ever seen.
Yes.
And prior to that, it would probably have to be, well, maybe War of the Sontarans, but Flux notwithstanding.
I was going
to
say,
Flux notwithstanding, two Doctors, maybe? Because I can't rate
because they did almost invade Gallifrey.
Yeah.
But other than that, they've been pretty sad. Like,
I suppose. They're kind of, you know what they remind me of? And this is a hockey analogy. Kind of remind me of, like, the New Jersey Devils. A team that just sort of, like, is kind of middling. Sorry, New Jersey Devils. Sorry, Ken, deep. You know, like, sort of middling franchise. And then they win three Stanley Cups somehow. Like, you know, like, oh, they won? What? Okay. And then they go back to just sort of being middling again. And that's kind of what the Sontarans are. I did like... it was Dan Starkey's Sontaran when they put Jericho and Claire in the psychic bit there. This is your reward will be success or death. And then Jericho goes, what's our reward for success? Death.
Yes.
That was good. Yeah, which the Sontaran stuff was pretty funny. Yeah,
you know that's
what he's going to say.
You know, but the fact that he did it is just great. Possibly makes up for a scene that I didn't have a problem with, but apparently one of us did here, and that's the corner shop scene with the Sontaran chocolate.
I like the notion of the Sontaran going native. right. It's like, oh, I found this what do we call the mouth?
Your mouth snacks or whatever.
Mouth snack wrapped in paper.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. The description was fantastic, I thought.
The description was it was great. And as Kat put it, that is far and away the most expressive and emotive Sontaran ever.
Yep.
I just like the idea that there's a Sontaran in the ranks who's secretly a chocolate fiend. I think that's wonderful.
I like that.
It is fundamentally stupid, but it's still kind of funny.
And the Sontarans get drunk from chocolate.
Yeah.
or just like, I remember a kid's birthday party once. Seeing his first taste of chocolate at 1 year old and watching his eyes bug out. And that's what this reminded me of, just going, what is this? Oh, what is this glorious substance?
As a plot point of having, so two aspects to this. Number one, as a plot point to having Claire and Jericho get into the story in the way that they do. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's fine. It's there. You got to have something, and that works well enough. But everyone with people going on about in Spyfall, the Doctor not asking for consent from the two women when she wipes their memories, and then that kind of getting undone in Flux when she does ask for permission. She's like, yeah, I got these two people that are going to, you know, help you out and whatever without, as far as we know, asking Jericho. Mm-hmm. Definitely before she asks Claire. So it's that didn't, you know, that could have been a little bit better handled.
Right. Well, there are a few things perhaps that could have been handled a little better. I don't know. I do like, I'm just going through my list again. I apologize, but where... who was it now? I think it might have been Claire or somebody. So maybe it was Kate who sort of says, oh, we'll do this and then this. And again, then the Doctor goes, nope, my plan is actually riskier than that. I just love the way she said that. Yeah. This ties back to Jodie Whittaker being great in this story. I like the spinoff series. Your time is heading to its end, which Time says to the Doctor in the guise of the Doctor in a different coat. So this feels like almost kind of like the Ood or the woman on the bus in Planet of the Dead sort of presaging.
It's not quite as heavy-handedly put together as either of those.
The woman in the shop giving tech support to Clara.
Yeah, so at least there's, you know, Time would know, you know.
I take that back because I thought the Ood in Waters of Mars was pretty cool, but the woman on the bus was way too heavy-handed.
It was a little bit too heavy-handed.
It definitely had a he will knock four times kind of vibe to it for
a little bit, but it
wasn't all bad.
But it wasn't then, like someone with second sight on the bus. It was time itself apparently knowing.
Sure. And time also says, you know, watch out for, you know, watch out for whatever it is. And their master in the subtitles, because obviously there's the implication is, you know, the master, be it Sasha Dewan or not, the master's coming back.
Yeah.
In the subtitles, the two times the word master is said, both times had a capitalized M.
Yeah.
Spoilers. Here's the thing about subtitles, and or closed captions. If you watch the news and you see closed captioning, it's remarkably often it's wrong.
They're doing that on the fly, though.
No, yeah. I know, but what was I watching the other day? I was watching something that wasn't a news. It was some like actual TV show, like a streaming thing with captions on, and half the captions are wrong. So sometimes it's automated. Who knows?
There's another one that I saw where Stank, did you say?
Stank
was
doing
the original broadcast.
Yeah.
To the other foes. In the subtitles it says uneasy, UNEASY alliance. Later on it says an easy, ANEASY.
Right.
See?
So
the subtitles aren't
necessarily right.
That's true.
Exactly. But I did love that he makes a point of saying during his whole big speech, this is an uneasy alliance. he's just thoroughly and brutally honest about the whole thing, betraying them.
Yeah, and good for him for doing that.
I was going to jump it's kind of fresh here. As the live stream chat is talking about when the doctor's talking to time, the reversed coat, that looked really good.
I really like that coat. I like that she remarks that she'd love the coat because it's cool. But every doctor seems to go darker in coat, like from McCoy to Tennant. I'm trying to think which other doctor went darker in the coat.
Colin Baker went blue.
Well, does tweed to purple, is that dark? I guess it's darker.
Yeah. I have two more things that I want to deal with, and then I have a question to ask, and then that's it for my notes. But the one, I really liked the both reunions of Bell and Vinder and Dan and Di. I really liked that. Like, the scene, the music, everything. I thought that was a great scene.
Even though for Dan and Di, like, they run, they hug, and then they separate, and it's like...
I like that.
It just goes a little awkward.
I like that. I think it's kind of like, you know what, Diane has had a time, and I think at the end of all that... that maybe she does not want to be with Dan at the end of that. Again, I feel like that scene could have breathed.
It's totally fair. I 100%
I really like that. I agreed with it. I think it's probably easy just to say, oh, of course they just wind up together because why wouldn't they? They actually, you know, they were going to meet for a drink and then they're mostly separated for the entire duration of the story and a ton of stuff happens to each of them. And, you know, they're not the same people as when they agreed to go have that drink.
Oh, he's been gone for 3 years or more, right?
Yeah, so, it reminds me of, like, Martha running, you know, traveling the world for a year at the end of Series 3, and she's not the same person coming back.
Maybe I'm just being too literal with the you were late thing. So
yeah, I know, yeah. Possible. I think you were late. It means, like, you were late to pick me up, but you were late to be with me life. You know,
I'm not a very smart man, so I don't understand these
things. That's all right. Also, Dan has no home still. Like, how much is the universe still, is it fine? Did the Sontaran invasion happen?
I don't know if any of that happened. We have
no reset button. So yeah, I got to think that the Flux has done whatever damage to the universe and that's going to persist going forward.
So that's like they just Thanos'd basically,
or
with no blend backwards.
And Dan presumably still has no house because we don't see it get like reconstituted. So maybe that kind of like.
Oh, on the other hand, he does have that house; it's in his pocket.
Yeah, or there's also like when Nazir's saying, "Oh, what we're going to do is just completely play back the destruction of the universe on a loop." And I thought, here's their way out. They'll basically wait until it gets around to the beginning again and say, "Stop the tape right there," and they'll be back, and the universe will be back to normal. But I gathering that didn't happen. So basically, everyone's sort of like, "Oh, remember that time when Sontarans were like all over here and like there's still holes in the ground near the Christ the Redeemer statue when there's a big giant Sontaran ship there." Or maybe not. Maybe no one remember that, just like no one remembers being dragged across the universe by a TARDIS like the planet Earth was at the end of Journey's End.
Sure.
Silly.
Or they could just hand wave it away at the beginning of the New Year's special. Yeah. I guarantee that's going to happen. They'll just hand wave it away. Like literally they did here, where I guess not hand wave, hand dodge, because he's like got the hand up to her in the climax. And then how does she get out of it? She just kind of moves to one side.
Yeah.
cliffhanger done.
I suppose so. Yeah, they get out of cliffhangers pretty easily. Who is time? What is time?
We're going to find out, maybe, possibly, probably
is
not.
Is it a person? Is it a concept that sort of takes whatever form it wants? Doctor, could it be both?
Some entity.
Okay.
Yeah. Like one says, we might find out later.
We might.
Or not. At the beginning of the season, as a betting man, I would have said, yes, we totally will. And now as a betting man, I'm like, well, are we really going to find out? Or is it just going to wander off and go on to something else?
Right. I don't know. I feel like there's some loose ends. I feel like Joe Martin's coming back. I feel like Unit's coming back. This is me guessing. I mean, I thought Tectaeon was coming back, but he's dead.
She did come back, and good. Kaboom. Yeah. Off she went to Glitterland.
Would you guys... So after all the WTFing about mutton chops, what do we think about his stories?
I like it, but maybe I don't like that he got basically a bigger goodbye than some of the people who we've been.
That's
with
true. I hadn't thought about
just
that.
Just like madam.
Also,
like
I had to rewind Paul Hollywood handshake. I'm like, what'd she say? Whoa, oh, okay, all right. I kind of get that.
That was great. I haven't watched Great British Bake Off in years now since it left the BBC, but. I did have a laugh.
I've never watched British Bake Off, so I've always had to be reminded Paul Hollywood's a person who exists. Because that name sounds fake, frankly.
I know. It is a weird name that it's called that. But now I think that's two of four hosts of it. Now I'm wondering, is Matt Lucas, who's on that show now, is he canon now, basically?
Is Nardole actually hosting?
Is Nardole hosting the Great British Bake Off in Doctor Who land? I don't know. Who knows? Did anybody help? I feel like we've talked a lot, but we haven't talked enough about the last episode of the last regular season of Doctor Who that we're going to have for probably 2 years.
We've got 3 weeks till next one, something like that. So
yeah.
So it doesn't seem like it's the last episode.
27 days.
It's on
a Saturday. By happenstance.
Proper Saturday, January 1st, Eve of the Daleks, because the current series delights in naming Doctor Who episodes featuring Daleks that almost are like previous stories of Daleks, like Revolution.
Who is this
evil?
What does she want?
Eve of the Daleks, not Evil of the Daleks, which I just...
Before we get to like next time and whatever, and wrap-ups and whatever, did you have anything left on your list for episode 6?
Let's have a look here. I don't think so. I think I mostly... got everything in there. I purposely shrunk mine to be 10% quicker, just like the episode did. But it's the same amount of notes, just crunched in a slightly smaller font. Yeah, sure, exactly. Yeah. What are your remaining notes there, Chris?
So I found it amusing. So at the introduction or at the first bed after the. So you had talked about door number 9 last time, Stephen. What's mm-hmm. behind it and whatever. So Yaz opens door number 9, kills the Sontarans. But the the first door they went through and they're on the cliff with lava and all that kind of stuff. Was that the Mordor?
Boo.
That's terrible. You should be ashamed of yourself.
Boo, but yay. Boo, like a reluctant boo. Okay, that's what you're getting on that one.
It's New Year's Eve horn.
I liked how after the doctor dodges the head to the hand from Swarm, I like how she rises above the bait of the Fob Watch to kind of like get her to comply with them.
Yeah.
Obviously, later on, she has it, and we talked about that. But I like that she just didn't, you know, go right for it as... you know, some characters might have done.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Yep. It was really shaping up to be a debate, will the Doctor save the universe or find out about herself? And that was actually not the debate that actually winded up happening, you know?
I totally can buy Swarm and Azur wanting to just, you know, sit back and as was, you know, phrased, you know, watch on a loop the end of the universe over and over and over and over again. They've seen, you know, sadistic and whatever enough to want to do that.
Yep.
So mm-hmm. That's fine.
Listen, I have watched Maple Leaf playoff losses several times.
I'm sorry.
No, because I love it. Schadenfreude. Schadenfreude is a delicious drug. I have watched so many Maple Leafs losses in the playoffs, like over and over and over again. I get it.
I'm trying to think if there's. I can't think of the equivalent of that.
You can't. This is
but,
what.
I'm sure there is one, but
this
I can't
is what
think
being
of
a sports fan is like, Warren. It's not cheering for things you like. It's cheering against things you don't like. It's equally as rewarding, and that's.
Oh, okay. I do that when a movie I think sucks.
Yeah.
Gets really poor box office.
Exactly.
Kind of the same thing.
How many times over the years have we completely dumped on Star Trek Into Darkness, and every time we see a negative review online, we go, "Look it, there's another one. Frame it.
Validation."
Yep. Anyway, Chris, you were saying.
I still love Dan and Carvanista.
yep.
You know, Dan walks in when Carvanista's in the cell. He's like, oh, be nicer. You won't get a biscuit.
Mm-hmm. I thought their scene was good. Carvanista and the doctor. There's the doctor talking to this anthropomorphic dog, mm-hmm. The first one we've seen in Doctor Who since Terminus. And it's actually a very like powerful scene because he's saying, you know, I've got this thing in my head. You know, if I speak any about it, 3 seconds, I'll be dead. Like,
So how old is Carvanista?
I think he's quite old.
Because he's got to be, because the division predates the doctor. So it's at least the doctor that we know of. So
yeah.
It's at least 2,000 years old.
Unless he's been, or he's been like zapped into time or something far in the future. Like, we don't know his backstory mm-hmm. necessarily and how he got
yeah,
there.
Yeah, who knows?
Cryosleep yeah. here or there, who knows?
Obviously, dog ears in Carvanista's species are a lot well different from human dog ears, so to speak. Earth dog ears, yeah.
Sigh. Mordor. The Mordor.
Mordor.
That's enough. Quit milking it.
And then the last thing was, okay, so how could it be that the Dalek and Cybermen fleets are going to be absorbing the flux
right
when it's already ripped through however much of the universe, you know, tearing apart planets and whatever mm-hmm. on its way? No sense of any sort of like diminishment or abatement, but now a bunch of ships are going to get in the way and stop it. And this is because this is before, I was said before the Ood says he'll try to do what he can to kind of minimize the
yeah.
flux
yeah.
final event. But still, like, that just seems, I don't know, if logical oversight or plot. I don't know
I think that you didn't even funnel it in to basically where the Earth bubble, like the ship bubble was, because those mm-hmm. ships are like made of antimatter.
Well, the Lupari ships and their shields and whatever, that's over and above what the doctor says about these Dalek and Cyber fleets absorbing the flux. And in the right. end, didn't work anyway, because some of the flux still made it through the Lupari barrier.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, that's where, you know, Companion comes in and absorbs the remainder or whatever.
Right. Passenger comes in.
Passenger, sorry.
That's right.
It's just like that just doesn't make any sense.
Here's my question for something else that doesn't right. make sense. Lupari's shield reminds me of something Mr. Burns said once. For eons, men's word destroy the sun. I'll do the next best thing and block it out. Which, you know, half of Earth at any given time right. is going to be freezing cold and like thrown into like nuclear winter because the stupid shield's in front of it. Like
right.
blocking the sun.
That I don't know.
And I had a couple things for Eve of the Daleks when we get there, but that's my list for Vanquishers.
Perfect. Warren, you got anything left to say?
Yeah, I think I got no more gas in the tank for this one.
No, I'm. I still liked this season greatly. I just thought it was a bit rushed. I don't mm-hmm. think there was any like, you know, great missteps. I don't think. I think with more time, but then it's also, you know, other shows that I've been watching have been made during COVID, but weren't. Mm-hmm. They didn't really have a time. I feel like Doctor Who was sort of, they were airing this here. I feel like other shows basically said, oh, well, I guess we're just in pause and then we'll make the show later. Or they were in the midst of production and they had to pause and then resume production kind of thing. And so they didn't really have a necessarily timeline. I felt like maybe there wasn't enough time, oddly enough, to develop this and to maybe make it as they wanted to. but they still mm-hmm. did it, damn it, you know, and I appreciate that. And
well, it's like, you make me think of Terrence Dix talking about season six.
Right.
And how production was, what, like a week, 10 days in advance of broadcast?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, how the hell did they ever manage to mm-hmm. to get something together to put it on the air? But at the end of the day, they got it on the air, and that's what matters.
That's TV, baby. That's how it works.
You know, greatest show in the galaxy, Asbestos Scare in BBC Studios. Guess what? We have to shoot this in a tent. Let's pull together and shoot this. Actually benefits
and blowing
from
up being, Sylvester McCoy.
Yeah, and basically is benefiting from shooting in a tent on Elstree mm-hmm. Studios parking lot. You know, it's a show that sort of is always kind of like Paul McCartney says in Get Back, you know, we're best where our backs are against the wall. And I thought...
But honestly, all TV is like this. TV more than movies. Is. Movies you can throw a money hose at. TV, you don't have that option.
TV, you don't have the option. And I think whatever faults I have with... what happened over the last six episodes, I can sort of look, they did this during COVID. They had to do a lot of compromises to get it done at all. Mm-hmm. you know, they,
so is this a 61 asterisk kind of situation for you?
No. Or? Oh, I see. Like Roger Maris's home run record. No, you know what, if anything, I feel like I appreciate it even more. You know, given what they had to work with and how they basically had to say, we had this plan, and then all of a sudden everything went, like, I'm wondering, I desperately want to know the whole story behind this. Like, what was the original idea? When was that starting to cook? When did they have to say, okay, we have to stop? Because, you know, it's not like they were in the midst of pre-production or anything. Like, they weren't building sets or stuff. Basically COVID was already a thing when they were sort of like getting to write the thing.
If
only we still had Doctor Who Confidential. There has to be a book. There has to be a Blu-ray when this comes out from the people at BBC, Chris Chapman and all.
So obviously Moffat hasn't done anything of the sort, but no. With R2-D releasing a writer's tale back in the day,
mm-hmm.
I wonder if Chibnall would ever consider doing some sort of like production journal.
No.
Well, given his prodigious output for Doctor Who magazine, probably not.
Barely showed up for that. I don't think we're going to hear it. I think we're the only place we're going to hear it.
Well, now that he's done with the show, though, I mean...
Mm. Yeah, he'll have another show. He's probably moving on to something else, I would guess.
Probably.
That's one more thing I wanted to mention, just is when, in relation to if there was a longer cut of this, I'm reminded of something that someone who worked on the show said to me. I don't want to say their name, just in case. But basically, that person worked in the Stephen Moffat era, and whatever was on the page, basically, they shot, even though they knew that probably 10 minutes were going to get cut out because mm-hmm. they didn't have time to put it on there. Whereas the Chibnall era, basically everything that gets written is in there. So there's no extraneous bits. And I'm wondering if that maybe changed around this time, because it feels like there was a lot of extraneous stuff that was cut out. For the first time.
Well, it shouldn't have been extraneous. It wasn't going to be extraneous.
Yeah, but the fact that,
circumstances.
You know, circumstances. We got to get to those strictly results. This again, we land on the theme of my argument for this whole calendar year, that this again, instead of having to fit Doctor Who into a 60-minute slot on BBC One on a Sunday night, it could have been a 74-minute episode or something with a lot more room to breathe.
Well, that wouldn't have changed the COVID restrictions. The conditions they were under
based on the edits.
If they had shot more.
Yeah.
Because if you think of back in the day of what RTD did, mm-hmm. he would say to the BBC, well, I've got a 60-minute time slot. I need 71. Give it to me.
And he did. You know,
and he'd get it.
Because this is in the day when Doctor Who was ruling the roost on Saturday nights. And now, mm-hmm. strictly, we got to get that results show. That results show has to happen at a certain time. And so you notice that Doctor Who would be nudged earlier in the day, but strictly starts.
As a stats guy, how do you feel about that? Because it's results. It's results.
It's
stats.
Results. I know. It's why Doctor Who must abandon its terrestrial broadcast strategy.
I like how you're absolutely convinced of your rightness on this and how much pull you have in making it happen.
Yeah.
I think let's do a Doctor Who
podcast. I have pull, Warren.
Let's leave the stats for the stats part.
Yeah, please do.
So
it's coming, though.
Or just leave them. Leave them at all.
It's coming. It's coming in time. So two things that caught my eye relative to Eve of the Daleks. Number one, the Dalek now having like a minigun style blaster.
That is interesting.
That is pretty badass.
Yeah.
Hey, now we know why the little infinity symbol is there on the marketing material for it as well. So, because it's a time loop story.
So. Okay, my thing with Eve of the Daleks was I don't think this is in the trailer and the show itself, but it is in the ad. They introduce the one guy and he's saying hi to the woman, and the woman's like, "Yeah, hi, we're going here. We go again." And then you see it's a time loop thing. Uh-huh. But at first, you see him get shot. I'm like, "Oh no, another black person got shot by a Dalek. Why does this happen every year?"
Yeah.
And then it turns out everybody's getting shot over and over. I'm like, "Okay, phew, everybody's getting killed. Right. Thank God."
Thank God everybody's getting killed. Okay, we're
good.
Safe.
Murder then. Everyone. Yeah. Just please stop singling out black people. This is getting ridiculous. I mean,
it's a measure of equality, I suppose.
It is. Yes, but Eve of the Daleks, Doctor Who was already announced that it was returning New Year's Day with a special. They didn't announce the details or indeed the name of it. Eve of the Daleks. Daleks are back. Three New Year's Days. New Year's Day.
The Daleks are back after we just saw their entire fleet get destroyed.
They're never gone. Yep.
Of course, they're
hot
never
and cold
gone.
On many a Christmas special from RTD and less so with, well, I don't know, Moffat right. too, but I don't need to have three Dalek specials in a row. Especially since they just got destroyed. Like, what the hell's going on here?
How many season finales in a row did we have the Daleks under RTD?
You know, I suppose. Like, I'm not going to hate a Dalek story.
Three out of four.
I had to count. I'm literally going, three?
It just seems odd that every time there's a New Year special, it's always the Daleks.
Yeah.
And it wasn't so bad last time because it was more of a follow through of the original. And, you know, and this one just seems kind of, I don't know.
But
I know nothing about it in the 10 seconds I've seen.
It's also something where other than brief little clips, like when Bell watches the Daleks go by on that one planet the brief appearance at the end here, they're not in the season proper.
That's fair. No. That's fair.
So you're never gonna get away from the Daleks.
No.
You're not gonna have like a 7-year gap like the Cybermen had.
No.
In 3 weeks' time, I may be completely recanting on this.
Mm-hmm. I like them. I know some of our friends are like, "Oh, we're tired of the Daleks." You know what? Every Dalek story is the first Dalek story for some viewers, and I would never want to wish that. I remember when I first saw Destiny and Resurrection of the Daleks, and I loved Destiny. And then when Resurrection happened, like, I was like, "Oh my God!" I literally put a countdown on my wall to the day that the next time Resurrection of the Daleks came on.
I saw Genesis first, so I'm gonna gatekeep you, right?
I know. I never saw Genesis until much later, but
that is a really cool way to be introduced to the Daleks because I knew nothing about them until that happened.
You know,
we'll find out. We'll find out in a few weeks what happens if they continue on the same trend or not. But for Resolution and Revolution, they both involved, you know, these Daleks getting created in a very different non-Dalek way.
Yeah.
And although now we got these
although in Revolution, it's the Daleks at their hand. Anyway, so we have obviously different Daleks as we see. Mm-hmm. From the trailer, so maybe we're gonna have other mishandled origin story.
Maybe Lenny Henry. Lenny Henry will be involved in bringing these ones.
Am I crazy, or did they have the lights from the TV movies, or have they always had those and I just haven't noticed?
I didn't look closely at the trailer.
Not the TV movies, the two Dalek movies. Like, they got the more pointy head thingies, like headlights. Not the more rounded ones, but the more sort of vacuum tubey ones.
I didn't notice. I'm sorry, Warren. I can't help you on that one.
Call yourselves fans.
I'm a bad fan. Listen, I watched the episode and I watched it again in the trailer and I jetted immediately to work and then rushed home to talk to you.
That's fair. That is fair.
Right.
The trailer on YouTube is different than the one we saw
after the episode. No. So,
it's longer.
Yes, yeah. It's longer. Good. So check out the version on YouTube.
All right. Well, there. Is that it then? Is that it for our review of Doctor Who? I mean, we might revisit this or something in the new year. Who knows? But maybe. For now, is that it?
I think so. Success then? You think?
I think so. Thing? Yep. I think
I need to watch this in total again before I decide.
I would like to too. I would like to. Go on, Chris. Sorry.
For the 20 minutes I saw of Halloween Apocalypse before we started recording, I was kind of digging on it and again just reestablishing the foundation of where we were.
Right.
To put everything into context. And Stephen, you had said earlier on that you think this is the Chris Chibnall that the BBC thought they were getting when they hired him for the job because of Broadchurch, et cetera. So Yeah. Do you think they're going to do this again?
I would hope so. I would hope that this is I've said this on this podcast before. I feel like season-long stories, not just, you know, loosely joined arcs. I think season-long stories is just the way
we'll see what RTD is up to, because that's where it's going to happen.
That's true. I'm intrigued. I mean, I never binge things, but I am maybe next year, January, when I have some free time again, I might just plop down on a day off and maybe not like watch it religiously, because I watch these episodes a lot over the past 6 weeks, mostly the Sundays of the reviews, but I would just like to see how this hangs together for six straight hours, essentially. Like a lot of people would do. A lot of people are probably just saving all these up and just binging it.
I'd watch one a night. I don't think I'd watch all 6 hours at once. But I wouldn't watch 25 hours of studio footage either. So
I might watch like one or two in one sitting and maybe three. Just to get that, how does this hang together? All things told, and see how, you know, because I think sometimes when you're also like putting together an episode, this is kind of a thing that entered my mind as well when I was thinking like, you know, you work on it, so you know what the story is in your mind. And it's tough to separate from the mind of you making it to just being an ordinary viewer. And it's like, so yeah, totally, this makes sense for anyone who's watching it the first time. You don't know that because you've just literally been writing this thing for 6 months and been making it for 3 months and then watching it as if, like, you know the whole story back to front, you know? How does it sit together to a common viewer just watching it for the first time?
I've seen a few people today in talking about the Vanquishers, say things along the lines of, "Oh, a casual fan would never know what's going on."
I'm not a casual fan.
No one other tuning out in droves. Blah blah blah. It's part six of a six-part story. If you haven't seen the first five, I don't care who the hell you are. You're not going to follow along.
If you watch season three of Succession, you're not going to understand what's going on.
Yeah,
because you haven't watched season one and two.
Yeah,
yeah.
Drop in this week to episode four of Star Trek Discovery without having seen any of the first three episodes, and tell me what you think
Discovery,
is going on.
Discovery, no spoilers, but Discovery this season has been like everything is so radically like there are the through lines, but for the main story, everything's just so dramatically, radically different from everything else for the first handful of episodes we've had so far. Mm-hmm. And I watch it and I don't know what's going on necessarily.
No,
that's me at the end of every season to start to discover, like, who's fighting what now? Okay, whatever.
Yeah, I like that. I like that I have that opportunity to just sort of watch things as a very casual fan, not looking anything up on the internet, because, you know, a lot of people probably watch Doctor Who that way, and I never know what that's like because I'm obsessed with this stupid show.
You never will. No. The one adventure you can never have.
Well, speaking of such things, we are, I think it's 8 episodes out of the 10 through Foundation. Right now,
we're only three
on Apple TV Plus.
Right. I've seen the whole thing.
Great series. I'm really, really enjoying it.
Right.
Never read any of the source material by Asimov.
Mm-hmm. But you don't really need to, honestly.
I'm told it doesn't really match just because of how the original stuff was structured and split and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and also there's different casting and but as somebody who did read the books, there are bits and pieces and you're like, oh, this ties back to that and that sort of ties back to this, and there's you know, so and I don't remember a whole lot, but I do remember bits and pieces and I'm like, oh, okay, I remember that name and this thing and this other character that I can't talk about.
I'm enjoying the hell out of it. And it's very. Like, it's really slick, really well acted.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's expensive.
Best work I think I've ever seen Lee Pace do.
The money.
Lee Pace is great now. Yeah.
Money.
Lee Pace is amazing.
Yeah, it's a lot of money.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, I don't know what the thing costs, but it's expensive.
I think it's easily $10 million per.
It's the.
What's the Amazon budget for the Lord of the Rings?
So much money. So
I know with Wheel of Time, they're spending $10 million per episode. And people are complaining. They're like, why isn't everybody all dirty? It looks too clean. I'm like, not everything has to look like Game of Thrones. It's fantasy. It can look like something else. Like, I mean, I've only watched 3 episodes of it, and I didn't mind it. It's not the best thing ever, but it's fine. But yeah, it's like everybody's like, well, it has to look just like Game of Thrones. I'm like, no, it doesn't. Mm-hmm. Like, it could look like whatever the hell they want it to look like.
We've watched 3 episodes, and you know, I'm not saying we need to watch the rest of it right away. I feel like, and this is one more than a few reviews that I've seen, I'm tying this back into Doctor Who, is that a lot doesn't happen in it. It could, over the course of 10 episodes.
Depends on the episode.
But, so you... I think if you're looking for a happy space, I think 8 episodes of Doctor Who Flux is probably it. I feel like there's probably not enough plot stretched over 10 episodes of Foundation. There's too much plot stretched over 6 episodes of Doctor Who Flux.
There's another Apple TV Plus sci-fi show called Invasion.
I've got
one episode in and gave up.
Which we've watched all 9 that have come out so far.
Right.
that is like the textbook definition of, at least seemingly, mm-hmm. nothing happening.
Right.
For 55 minutes at a crack.
I know.
Despite old timey Sam Neill, which is, you know, definitely a drama.
But. So I'm, you know, for all its faults of it feeling like too tightly packed, I'd rather have too much stuff in a Doctor Who episode than not enough, you know, basically having the Doctor and Herbert arguing around a console for 6 minutes.
Okay.
In Timelash, you know, just to bring it back to classic Doctor Who, because that's all I know about. So.
But you also got the Doctor and Perry strapped in with a bungee cord yeah, harness things.
That wasn't padding, though, oddly enough.
Well, we got a Timelash, I ask you why.
I don't know. Well, we'll get to the
Timelash. Because
time
we're
going to
get to our own Timelash later.
That's true. Yes.
But first,
a much better one.
Well, before we get to that, though, of course, I mean, we have to. This is going to be here for the next, probably for the next episodes of this whole year, because we have so much to catch up on. No, it's time for. Yes. It's stats, everyone. It's our viewing figures, our AI, our all of our nonsense that we do.
I love how you rush to get your preamble in before the word stats comes, like you're some radio DJ trying to get the song title in before the lyrics.
Because I see the waveform about to hit, you see. I know when it's coming. That's what I'm doing. Let's start with our Twitter poll, which we haven't done. Boy, this polarized people. This episode polarized. We've talked about it for like an hour and 15 minutes. 28.9% loved it. 27.3% liked it. 21.7% said it was okay. 22% said it wasn't for me. That is like, those are like 4 equal doors pretty much right there. So
That's higher than Jason Kenney's approval rating.
Way higher.
I don't think we've ever seen that even a split.
No.
Ever.
At least the likes and the loves were still there, but yeah, obviously quite a few people out there were not happy. I don't know how you felt about it, dear listener, but you know, to each his own, to each their own, I should say. The overnight viewers viewing figures for Survivors of the Flux, which was episode 5, was 3.82 million. Tops for the evening was Strictly Come Dancing, the results show, which immediately followed Doctor Who. It got like 3 times the amount of people almost watching.
The enemy.
Yeah. Because it's the results, you know? Let's find out the results. Oh, okay. That person got voted off. Well, there we are. What else we have here? I'm opening the same link, Chris. I'm just going to read all the way down. Village of the Angels,
sure.
Consolidated viewing figures. Warren, listen up on this. 4.55 million.
I couldn't care less.
That was the lowest consolidated rating since the series returned in 2005, but it's still the 21st most watched program of the week, mm-hmm. which is still pretty much on par with literally everything that Doctor Who has been doing.
Yep.
Except for like...
And again, effectively top 20. Who wouldn't want top 20?
Exactly. So there. Except for like 3 weeks in 2008 when The Stolen Earth and Journey's End were ruling the roost and... Doctor Who fans like, oh, Doctor Who should be canceled if we're not number one of the week, like Journey's End was 13 mm-hmm. years ago when Twitter wasn't even invented, for crying out loud.
Or when Voyage of the Damned got 83 bajillion people.
Right? 13.7 people watched. Wow, it's just amazing. AI for Survivors of the Flux is 77, which is a fun number. Survivors of the Flux... BBC America overnight, slight increase from the week prior, 334,000, up from 318,000 from a week before. Listen, folks, the stats segment alone has validated us doing YouTube live streams, because I can see Warren now, as he has always done, probably. Just lie back and wish for death whenever we read these. And
it's, please embrace me.
It's great.
Oh, Dark Lord.
It's so great. So there. That's it for this week. But we'll have overnights for this. If we keep going, we'll have them during this episode. and other stuff next week. But the stats will fade out as the as December rolls along here a little bit. But
yep, and then we'll get a little uptick at in early January.
That's true. That's very true. Let's do businesses. We talked about this before when it was sort of not leaked or rumored, but it was out there that that Sony was buying Bad Wolf Studios. And now it's official.
Majority chunk of it.
Yeah. They put some money into it. There's a big press release. It's in really tiny font. I'm not going to read the press release.
No. I also like how we've gone from stats, which Warren hates, to Marat business.
Marat business, Warren.
I hate that less. It's interesting. It's strategic.
Was
the Sony memo the same type size as Jack Dorsey's resignation from Twitter memo?
Oh, I actually don't know. It's on like...
it's tiny.
It's white.
Unreadable.
It's white on black, which I'm never a fan of. I always like black on white. When it comes to web page, I know, I just don't want, there's like a Bad Wolf logo in the background. I was like, what are you covering up? What are you hiding, Bad Wolf?
What's going on, Sony?
Yeah.
Just too bad the Sony email hacks didn't happen once they bought Bad Wolf. Then we could find out all the inside dope. You'd get your own Reddit tale out of email hacks from North Korean hackers.
Oh, so many emails. If only we would made like a slightly controversial movie about Korea or something like that. That would, and then it comes out.
Oh, they still can. They can do it again.
And that's true. And then it comes out and it's like nothing burger. But anyway, links in the show notes if you want to read the whole press release on your own. But Sony Pictures now has a majority stake in Bad Wolf Limited. Those what are making Doctor Who possibly
Spider-Man
soon.
Crossover incoming
possibly multiverse, soon.
The only reason the multiverse is being introduced to the MCU is so Doctor Who can be part of it.
Probably,
which was a Marvel comic back in the old days. Mm-hmm. Reprinted.
I've got a friend who works for Sony in the camera division.
Cameras.
Postulating maybe now he can get a job working in Cardiff on Doctor Who.
That'd be kind of fun. I still want to go to Cardiff when they're making Doctor Who. That's a dream of mine post-pandemic. Maybe now that the Chibnall era is ending, maybe the iron curtain of secrecy around the Doctor Who set will lower a little bit. And there's,
you know,
another
thing. A dream of mine post-pandemic? Yeah. Going anywhere.
That's true. Anywhere at all. Here's another thing. One more thing I want to raise before we get to the Timelash. Thanks, everyone, by the way, for sticking with us, especially those of you on the live stream where it is very late or very early for you. I don't know which right now. Is that, remember when, like, mid-October, when all of Doctor Who's social media accounts, like, went down and everyone thought that, it's tying into the promotion of Flux. And then there was, like, a weird little trailer where the Doctor's just sort of, like, talking to camera and Dan and and Yaz are at the console saying, come on, Doctor, we need you, and all this and that. And everyone thought, oh, it's going to tie into Flux. Well, now that we've seen Flux happen, I think we can all agree that complete tire fire on social media.
Also, and I said it at the time, why is Dan should be nowhere near the console.
Nowhere near the console.
Knows how to operate it.
It's so weird. Dan. It's so weird that teaser video.
Graham had the sense to stay away.
Yeah, that teaser video had nothing to do with what happened to Doctor Who Flux whatsoever. You want to hear my tinfoil hat conspiracy theory on this?
Sure.
Yes.
I want to think that, because I do know that come the new era of Doctor Who, there will be a outside promotions department working on promotions of the show. I'm wondering if, like, maybe the passwords were, like, exchange, like basically the keys to the house were transferred over during that weekend, and maybe something
that
happened.
That would not surprise me in the slightest.
Some weird stuff behind the scenes. Well, actually, we have this email registered for these accounts, so you have to change it to a different email, and that takes 24 hours. And I'm wondering if that is literally what happened, because
that wouldn't obliterate the content.
It wouldn't. No, but it came back. It all came back, and it was on all the social media accounts. So I don't know where that thing, but it's quite clear that it was not intentional. It was just a complete
Jimmy the intern strikes again.
Something happened.
That idiot Tibor lost the key.
The Chris Chibnall era finally, towards the very end, had its own Marcello Camargo moment, and instead
it certainly did.
We had the Rose leak. We had the Rose leak, and for RTD, we had the Camargo leak of series 8 episodes and scripts, and this you know, comparatively was actually less worse, honestly, not so bad.
Like, so you lost social media. Okay.
Yeah,
whatever.
Exactly. Like, oh, okay. Twitter's back up. Well, there's your teaser. But anyway, it's very strange, I thought. But all right. On that note, let's dip back in time, in history, if you will, for this week in history, Doctor Who history. I'd love to tell you about December 5th, but it's pretty much expired everywhere around the world when we're recording this.
But talking of Series 8, Hellbent, wrapping up Series 8.
My God, Hellbent. I watched that
in
at home the first time.
Yeah, so did I.
We watched Face the Raven. Was I don't remember where Face the Raven was. Erica was, I'm just thinking back in time, Erica stayed in the States because we went on the big UK trip and then to the States, and so she stayed and watched that, and I watched it at home, and then Hellbent was at home, and I'm thinking, wow, I watched most of the last half of that series in different parts of the world, which is kind of exciting.
Briefly featuring Tania Miller, who was in Foundation.
That's right. Years and years.
She's quite good in Foundation, I think.
I haven't seen her in Foundation, so that's a spoiler.
It's not really a spoiler.
No. She gets in this episode 6 or 7.
Somewhere around there, I know what to look for.
No, you don't.
And she's been good in that other show that I never watched, featuring a haunted house. No, there's a haunted house. It's on Netflix. It might be on that bracket of best Netflix shows, or it might not be. I don't know. House on Haunted Hill. The Haunted House of Hills.
The Haunting of Bly Manor?
I would watch The Haunted House of Hills.
Haunting of Bly Manor. It's just a bunch of hills that are haunted. She's in it. She's very good. Hellbent's very, very good. It's not heaven sent, but it's still supremely good.
It was a little disappointing because it wasn't heaven sent.
Yeah, I agree. Boy, oh boy.
As I lose my voice.
A little bit. December 6th. Is a hell of a day because two eras of the Doctor come to somewhat unceremonious ends. Child of a Time Lord wraps up. Carrot juice, carrot juice, carrot juice.
Oh dear.
When you were talking about YTV's broadcast of Ultimate Foe episode 2, the way it was structured, rushed and all that kind of stuff,
right,
does make me think of the Vanquishers in some ways.
Yeah. A little bit.
There's a lot of crossover in there.
I wonder if Chris Chibnall had to say, well, okay, I'm pulling my script, my own script for my own series, and I'm going to have to watch you, Eric Sayward, write the last episode. But you can't you can't see what I've done in the original episode 6. Wasn't it that
infamous chat show where Chibnall ragged on Pip and Jane Baker to their faces? Yeah. Wasn't that about Vervoids?
Are they both dead now? Pip and Jane
Baker? They're both dead now. I bet you they're both looking down from heaven.
Right. Chris Chibnall, and scolding you mightily, saying, well, ain't so easy, is it, buddy?
Yeah. I just like to think of Jane Baker, you know, refusing to give Chris Chibnall, like, wanting to give everyone in the audience a piece of candy, but not Chris Chibnall.
And he held it in his bosom to this day.
No candy from the advent calendar that week. Also, 3 years later, Sylvester McCoy and Sophie Aldred walked off into the sunset, most of the trees, at the very end of Survival. I don't remember at the time, because I was sort of really, like, season 26 was the first season that I watched that was, like, basically at the same time. I saw it in 1990, but like I didn't get the impression that Doctor Who wasn't coming back, but I also thought, I've just spent the last 6 years watching all of it essentially, and now it was here, and thinking, I never got the impression that it was being canceled. You two were a little more active in fandom at the time. What was on your mind in December of 1989?
We were both part of a local Doctor Who fan club, so I mean,
yeah,
I'm sure there was scuttlebutt, but I couldn't tell you anything about it at the time, because that was almost 35 years ago, or 30 plus, whatever years.
It's a long time ago. Yeah.
I was glad to see the back of the McCoy era, and I still am.
Well, I know, but that also meant the end of Doctor Who, though. That's the thing. I mean,
price I'm willing to pay.
I literally just started reading Doctor Who magazine, basically, when they're saying, oh, by the way, welcome to Doctor Who magazine, issue 145 or whatever it was. I think this show's canceled now.
Yeah.
But we're still going.
I distinctly remember 1989, one of the main comics shops I would go to buy my weekly
comics. Was this Warp One Comics, the infamous Warp One?
No, it wasn't Warp 1. I can't remember the name of it now. It was on White Ave, 108th Street in White Ave.
The Edmonton klaxon is going here, by the way. But
yeah, sorry, everybody.
Yeah.
Anyway, he started bringing in, the guy who ran it, started bringing in Doctor Who magazine on a regular basis. So I remember there's this stretch of 4 or 5 months where I bought all the issues as they came out.
Right.
And that was like the most Doctor Who magazine I'd ever come across at any in any one like concentrated area. Because like before that, there'd be things like at the local Doctor Who fan club thing, people would buy Target books for resale, buy Doctor Who magazines for resale. So you might get the odd thing here and there, but nothing where you had like 4 or 5 issues back to back. That was unheard of.
My most treasured DWM was the one where they actually broke down how they did the Trial of the Time Lord camera move for the model in the beginning.
Oh.
And I read that over and over and over again. I think before I ever saw it.
About 8 times over the years.
Yeah.
But this is the first time. This is in the 80s, so.
Mm-hmm. As we move on from December, the sad thing is, and this is legitimately sad, is December 6, 1989 is the day of the Polytechnic Massacre in Quebec in this country, where 14 women were gunned down by a man. That's the worst day in history in this country. Well, one of them anyway. And so it's sad that this is such a legitimately awful day in history shares its day with the last episode of broadcast of Classic Doctor Who. Dragonfire, just to lighten the load a little bit, Dragonfire 3 and Silver Nemesis 3 air on consecutive years, 87 and 88, on December 7th.
How is that in any way lightening the load?
Because they are questionable episodes, let's just say.
That's very true.
They end seasons as well. And it's bad. Also, shows an anniversary date with Pearl Harbor. So, you know, we're really, really in good time of year, early December. Love it. Love all the good times that happened in early December.
Whee!
Yep. Dragonfire. The Invasion Episode 6, is that the one, the cliffhanger of which, or is it Episode 7, where they're walking down the steps of St. Paul? I think it's 7, isn't it? I don't remember.
It's been a while since I watched it.
It's been a while since I watched
it. I don't recall.
I don't know cliffhangers. I don't have cliffhangers. Nightmare of Eden, the only episode ever to air on December the 8th, any year, 1979, featured part 3 of Nightmare of Eden. The greatest Doctor Who story to ever air on December 8th. Ever.
And
December 1st. You gotta start fighting with the Time Warrior next week, but...
I think Time Warrior is a clear winner, frankly.
I don't know. Looking forward to that season 17 box set. Updated effects in Nightmare of Eden. I don't know how to feel about that, but I'll watch
CG them. Mandrills. What we've all been begging for.
I wonder if the BFI had an event today. Today being December 5th. For City of Death, speaking of which we still don't have on pre-order here in North America. I don't think, anyway. I'm sure Chris is going to Google that now, but...
Nope.
No, you're not going to Google it, or no, we don't have it.
I didn't hear what you said. I was typing in the chat.
We didn't say anything. Nothing.
I'll admit it. I wasn't making it.
That's fine. I was wondering, Chris, if we had season 17 Blu-ray set here in North America available for pre-order. This is what I'm thinking.
Ah.
You could, if you want.
I'm sure we would have both pre-ordered it by now.
We would have done. I haven't checked in like 3 days, which is a record for me. So, hey, I remember like it. Perhaps you might have been disappointed with the way Flux wrapped up, but you remember the Battle of Ranskorav Kolos that aired on December the 9th, 2018, and that was an episode that ended, and then it was done.
Yeah, I gotta say this is a better ending than that one was.
Yeah. Was somewhat subpar, wasn't it, as I recall? With some good scenes in it, but did not feel like an ending to a season.
No, it was kind of anticlimactic,
yeah.
This was climactic. For all its faults, it was definitely climactic.
Tell you what was climactic. The Power of the Daleks, Episode 6, which aired on December 10th, 1966. Boy, oh boy, I remember watching that for the first time, the recon, obviously, and was blown away quite literally perhaps, by the amount of machine gun fire in it, which yes. Was not a feature that you saw in Doctor Who very much at all at the time. And I remember musing with Steve Roberts after our interview at Gallifrey 1 a few years ago, and we were talking about maybe Power of the Daleks was coming back. And he was saying, imagine if it did come back and it came from Australia, how many censor cuts there would be in episode 6
totally.
Of that. And it's probably like, probably in a vault somewhere in ABC in Sydney, there's probably 17 minutes worth of censor cuts from Parallel.
Guarded by feral kangaroos.
Yeah.
This is it though. There are chunks of footage we have, brief clips though it may be, of things because the Australians cut whatever and kept it.
Probably the whole of episode 6 is probably in there somewhere, except it's in like
because it's nothing, it's an orgy of violence,
it's just all machine gun. Oh, cut that, just all the dead people, cut that, that's not good. Baby almost getting shot by a Dalek, cut, no. Leave that in.
Wow.
It actually happens in Power of the Daleks episode 6. There's a woman holding a baby and the Dalek is about to shoot them, and we don't know if they actually do it or not. It's dark.
I think I have Power of the Dogs. I've like, completely forgotten about
yeah,
this.
Yeah, it's
grim. It's like the stair scene from The Untouchables, Warren.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's not grim. Lastly, in the Timelash, Sarah Kingdom makes her official. She appears in the cliffhanger of the previous episode, but she becomes a traveling friend. I'm not going to call her a companion, just to throw controversy into the mix there. In episode 5 of the Daleks Master Plan, Counterplot, notable for existing today. Found in,
2, 5, and 10, right?
2, 5, and 10, which sounds like you're sorting Canadian money, but you're not. There was an article in a recent Doctor Who magazine about how and where the Daleks Master Plan 5 and 10 was found. 2 was kept by a TV technician for 20 years and said, oh, do you need this? I didn't know he wanted it. But 5 and 10 apparently like showed up in some basement of a former Mormon church. Like, no one can actually pinpoint where these two episodes came back from. It's one of...
Where does that fall in, like, the animating and putting up box sets scheme of things? Because you've got to think at some point they're going to animate this.
The fact that they've done Galaxy 4 really makes you think, they're going to start in Season 3 soon. They got a lot to do, though.
I mean, they animated how many episodes of The Invasion?
So. 2, because there's only 2 to two? Do. Oh. Yeah. But there's 9 to do for Dalek. And you have to think that they'll probably just do all 12 like they have for Evil and Fury. I mean, Abominable Snowman, they probably animate episode 2 even though it exists. So they probably do all 12.
I gotta say, watching animated stuff, it just, if I ever had misgivings, they're gone. Like, I just sit down, I'm like, oh, I'm watching Doctor Who. I don't even think about the fact it's animated until flip to a live action one.
Did I
and then
say
back
this?
To an animated one.
Yeah, I talk a lot to myself these days. So forgive me if I've either been talking to myself or saying this on the podcast, but I remember watching an animated, I think it might have been Mac or Terror, when they delete a scene because it's too hard to animate. But I thought the animated versions have, to me, become the new versions of target novelizations in that they are just they are a interpretation of the stories that are, accurate tellings of what happened, but they are slightly different. And that's kind of where I accept them as.
Or
dramatically different in some cases, like War Games having to cut down to 128 pages or whatever it was.
Yeah, exactly. So,
but that's the best option we got right now, so I'm cool with it.
I'm all right with it. And they put new Telesnap recons on the DVDs as well, so like they cover all the bases. It's
and it's a hell of a lot of work for some ancient show that barely anybody cares about besides nerds like us.
But that's where it rules to have the nerds like us running the show for these
things. Exactly. Yes, it is kind of insane that's. But I'm just saying it's a very lucky set of circumstances.
All right. Daleks Master Plan, as you had mentioned, if they do an animation, there'd be 9 episodes to do.
Yep.
You think they'd ever think of leaving out Feast of Stephen?
No. God, no. You have to include it. Have to.
And include the student version on the
No,
Oh, sorry. I keep mixing those two up. I don't know why.
Right. I mean, one leads to the other, but...
Yeah. I think you have to. Why wouldn't you?
Oh, just animate her looking at the camera.
Eight, not 9?
just to make it easier. If you're doing that, and you're thinking, do we really need this last half of this episode? But you're just kind of, no, animate it all.
But
animate
when
it all.
He wishes everybody a happy Christmas at home, since you're animating it, do several different versions. One where he's not breaking the fourth wall, one where he is breaking the fourth wall, one where you look at the fourth wall and you see the camera people. Just draw whatever the hell you want.
Oh, but it's fascinating because Robert Jewell, who plays Bing Crosby in that episode, he's usually a Dalek operator. He's responsible for, 19 telesnaps because he took pictures of the screen because he knew he was coming up. That's the only visual record of that story that we have, because John Wiles, the producer, didn't order telesnaps during his time as producer of Doctor Who. And so we only have those 19 images, and some of them are a bit blurry, but one of them distinctly shows William Hartnell, in addition to the famous Merry Christmas to All of You at Home scene, turn to the camera and looks like he's saying something. I think Hartnell turns to the camera multiple times during that episode.
I wonder how drunk everybody was.
I'm so fascinated. Oh, my God. Honestly, Feast of Stephen, which I still maintain was actually made into a film copy of. We'll get to that next week in the Timelash. I still want to see that thing back. And maybe it shows up some. Maybe it's in someone's basement or some. Probably not, but still.
No, I thought they always said that was one that was never sold internationally.
Well, listen.
And probably didn't have a film print struck.
This, well, I have said this on this podcast. Oh, fine, I'll say it now. Basically, because December 15th, next week, is when they put a request across all Doctor Who episodes at the time. Because initially, I am really sorry for everyone who is staying up really late in the live stream for this. Because this, we're getting really technical here. Basically, the BBC said, because they had a mishmash of either suppressed field stored recordings on film or...
Oh dear. I'm both appalled and excited by what you're talking about.
They wanted to make better versions of the 60mm film for overseas. So they said, make new film versions for every episode that's aired up until now. And at that point, like December 1966, like Power of the Daleks. So they basically made all of them up until then. And, you know, Warren, we've had this conversation before. When you're working in TV, you don't say, oh, this one isn't going to be sold, because they didn't know it was going to be sold to us.
No,
or not.
The technician has no clue. No. Why would he?
So they basically, they probably took every single 2-inch master tape on the shelf, made a film copy for every single episode, because that's what technicians do, especially union technicians. So that's why.
Why would
you
get in trouble by not doing something?
Why would you think
that just doesn't
happen? Yeah, why would you think that, oh, this one won't be the one? No, that's why I believe,
Your job is not to judge any of that stuff. Your job is just to do the thing they told you to do, because you're the expert in doing it.
Ours is not to reason why, only to obey orders.
Also, when was this? 1960 what?
Six.
I was exactly minus 4 years old.
Right?
That's my birthday. So.
Oh, that's right. Happy birthday.
Well, 1970 is my birthday. I know. So,
We'll be sure to mention that next week, the Timelash. And maybe I'll have forgotten that I said all this, and I'll say it all again on the actual anniversary of the striking of all episodes on new and better film recordings. But until then, we'll wrap up our journey through Doctor Who history and the Timelash as our episode trucks along. Getting close to 2 hours long, everyone.
It's madness. Utter madness.
So we'll wrap this up with some other news. A big finish has in January next year, next month, because that's when January is, Doctor Who Peladon, the box set with Doctor Who's, or rather Doctors Who, returning to Peladon with David Troughton playing an older King Peladon, and Doctors Colin Baker and Paul McGann being there with River Song, with Ice Warriors, and Alpha Centauri.
That's the key. I want to know if Alpha Centauri is in this.
Yep. Craziness.
And is it the woman, the original woman's voice? She's like 90 now or whatever she is?
No.
It is Jane Goddard who's doing this. Doing the voice, because she is very old, but she's still with us, thankfully. But no, she's not in it. But a whole host of other people who you've recognized from Doctor Who are in it. So, you can order it now. You can order it now. It's coming out in January. Coincides with the 50th anniversary of the Curse of Peladon.
Jane Goddard is Robert Sherman's wife.
You are correct. Yeah. Mira Sahl is in this as well. She was in the Silurian two-parter. Way back when. That's all I know off the top of my head. Jason Watkins was in W1A. There we are. And Nightmare in Silver. And Sarah Powell is in the Sunshine
Alex Kingston credit for being so employable. She's in practically everything Big Finish is doing.
That's true. That's true. Good for her. You know? Like David Tennant.
She's great. Don't get me wrong. I love her song. So.
She's absolutely fabulous. Yeah. Chris is obviously at some point did do some digging on Amazon because he's posted in the news list things that are coming soon, not even soon, mid next year from the BBC in the way of books and audio. June 2nd, 2022 in the UK and possibly everywhere sees the release of the radio episodes. The third, fourth, and sixth Doctor audio dramas that were originally broadcast on radio. So we're looking at The Paradise and Death and Ghosts of Endspace in the 90s, which of course featured John Pertwee, but those are the last ones made. Doctor Who and the Pescatons gets a proper re-release.
Yes, good old Pescatons.
Exploration Earth, Whatever Happened to Susan, and Slip Back. We finally get Slip Back.
Oh boy, we've been pining for it so hard.
I'm sure it's come out in some form or another, but you can get it as an official.
Slipback had a Target novelization.
I had the book, and I never finished it. It's one of the few I didn't read.
Did it have... It did have its...
They did.
It did. I can see the cover in my head.
Behind me on
the
shelf that I'm kind of pointing to somewhere is going to be Slipback.
That's amazing. I think I've forgotten all about that. The fact that Slipback existed. Really, let's face it.
You're not wrong to do that.
Really. Exactly. Right. That's just wise.
There's also an audiobook coming. It's called Doctor Who, The Resurrection Plant. It's a Second Doctor audio original. This is from the BBC. This is actual proper BBC, a book about the Second Doctor read by one Fraser Hines, who is basically de facto Second Doctor now when it comes to reading things. So that's coming in August. Plan ahead, August. What wave of the pandemic will we, what variant will be ruling our lives?
The Tektuin variant.
Tektuin.
Yeah.
the Carvanista variant.
Yeah. Also.
Well, that'd be okay. We become dogs. They seem to be happy.
Doctor Who Origin Stories is coming out in the autumn, apparently August 18th, but the temp cover art says autumn 2022. We don't have authors. Perhaps it's just the origin stories of every character who appeared in Flux. That we didn't get a good backstory to. Maybe that's who it is. But
you mean like Azur and Swarm?
Like Azur and Swarm. Maybe we'll find all about them. It won't happen on TV. It'll actually show up in this Doctor Who origin story.
It's called transmedia, my friends. Transmedia.
Is it really?
It's not.
No, okay.
That is the term for when you have stuff, you know, like Star Wars everything on a Happy Meal and in a book and in a DVD or whatever else. Like,
right.
Yeah.
Chris on the live stream is showing us his physical copy of Doctor Who Slipback, the novelization.
Written by Eric Saward.
Eric Saward. Well, only Eric Saward could write an Eric Saward story.
The first Doctor Who radio special, it says.
That is a really bad
That's
cover.
A lie. No, wait. Doctor Who and the Pescadons came out in record, didn't they? It wasn't on the radio.
Yeah. That's I remember right. taking that
he looks
off
like
the,
He looks like a crawl to let himself go.
Yeah, maybe you did. I think I had it. Did I have it on? No, I didn't have it on CD because I would still have that CD. But then again, I got rid of my Doctor Who VHS copies of the Cybermen and the Dalek ears and all the other ones because I'm an idiot. I have copies of them now. Thanks for asking. Hey, if you enjoy Doctor Who Flux, you can now enjoy them as pin badges. All the main cast members of Doctor Who Flux are to be released as pin badges. In those funky little style that we've talked about on the show before, which characters are here? We got what series of what? Seven.
Doctor Yaz, Dan, Carbonista, Swarm, Vinder, and Azur.
Azur, I love I like Carbonista one. That was pretty cool because it's a puppy.
He's got they're hero collectors. So
they're fun. They're fun. I like them. So you can get those. I want to point out the mask as used in the. Passenger costumes is a freely available mask in that same color that you can buy off Amazon.
I thought it was from Wish. I thought it was Wish.com.
I would never buy from Wish.com if there are ads or anything to go buy.
No, it's off of Amazon. Yep.
I saw people ragging on it, and I was like, so a cheap prop on Doctor Who? Like, oh, that's never happened before.
Yeah, it's never happened.
It's the entire history of the show. Come on.
I know this for a fact because... I ordered one. It's coming probably after Christmas. I am planning on wearing that to Gallifrey 1 whilst,
and a bathrobe
whilst with wearing stripes. No, whilst wearing my cable knit sweater, also bought off of Amazon and as seen in exactly that form on the Mon Calamari fisherman in an episode of The Mandalorian. I am wearing an Amazon cosplay at some point at Gallifrey 1 next year.
You are the Kablam man.
I'd rather you have a cable knit sweater as seen in Horror of Fang Rock.
I would too, because that's some good sweater action. Louise Jameson in the sweater is probably the best costume she had in Doctor Who. And speaking of Gallifrey 1, if you want to go to Gallifrey 1, and we do hope you do, vaccination only. No proof of negative test or anything like that. If you're coming to Vaccination City, I do not know why I called it that.
I want to hear that folk song. If you're coming to Vaccination City.
Yeah, I know. That's what I was thinking. If you're coming to Gallifrey 1, you must be vaccinated.
Guns N' Roses are turning over in their graves right now.
Yeah.
Good.
I was thinking of Scott McKenzie and if you're going to San Francisco.
Remember to wear an Amazon mask on your head?
That's true, because I will be for one day at least. Vaccination only to come to Gallifrey 1. 5 and over must show documented proof of vaccination against COVID-19, which honestly, we fully support this. I feel
absolutely
even better about going to Gallifrey 1 now.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah. I mean, I play hockey twice weekly, and you have to be vaccinated to go play hockey. And I feel great to do it because we're all vaccinated. So.
Or you can, you know, be in the NFL and just get a 3-game suspension. Or sorry, NBA. NBA?
He was immunized, which is some nice wordplay there, Aaron Rodgers.
Also in the thing from Galley, Sophie Aldred having to, alas, back out.
I know.
Her appearance.
I know. It's too bad because Fresh McCoy is going to be there. So. And also Roberta Ingranata, who's the colorist on Doctor Who comics. Titan. She's not going to be there, so.
Oh, uncool. Never mind.
Uncool. So, but many others will be there, and more guests will be announced soon as they are confirmed. Gallifrey 1 is just over 2 months away.
Madness. 73 days, 20 hours and change.
Yep. Recording. So. That's it for this very long episode of Ready for Skaro. Thanks, everyone, for listening, for watching Doctor Who Flux, for tuning in. For all of you who basically are the we love you all, but the Fairweather fans who tune in to listen whenever there's a new Doctor Who to be talking about, we love you all. We love all of you who've turned up for the live streams.
Brave souls, especially on the East Coast.
Yeah, we probably won't be doing these for the next couple weeks, but we will be back for New Year's Day. New Year's Day at about 10 p.m. Eastern time once again.
Kind of like today.
Sorry.
Kind of like today, except 10 p.m. Eastern. So, our normal time that we did for the first five episodes of this to talk about Eve of the Daleks. But we'll be back next week with a much shorter episode, as in not 2 hours long. And
famous last words.
And a more relaxed episode, perhaps, as well. And maybe and more stats and maybe more Flux afterthoughts and other things about Doctor Who that we like to talk about on this show, as we have done for the past 15 and a half years. And that's not just counting tonight. So until next time, everyone, I am Stephen in Edmonton.
Born in Vancouver.
And Chris in Edmonton.
So long for now.
You've been listening to Radio Free Skaro. Find us online at radiofreeskaro.com. Follow us on Twitter and Tumblr at Radio Free Skaro. Subscribe to us on iTunes and donate to the show at patreon.com/radiofreeskaro. Thank you.